looking for the day is content providers retrieve operation, delete operation, and update operation. And what we did yesterday was insert operation in content provider. Just to make one quick review, so when you start your content provider application, you'll get this kind of a registration page where the user can sign up. So we are just trying to punch the data into the table. You extract the user information. For example, we got this record Kim at some example.com, and then you enter some password Kim123, let's say female, some city, and then you say sign up. Now you can see Kim registered successfully with ID5. That means there are 5 records in my table as of now. Now what I want a menu item should come here. There should be a menu item in my toolbar. If I click on the menu item, I should be able to launch a new activity. And in that activity, I will display all the records which we have inserted in the table. So what is the use case as of now? For my retrieve operation, what I want from my sign up activity, I will open one new activity called all users activity, and here I will retrieve all users. So this retrieve operation, I am specifically going to do it with the help of list view. Clear to everyone what we have to do? Now in my sign up activity, so even before we proceed, this was the content provider which we used. So in my sign up activity, when you use your content resolver, so you inserted the data into the database, so you have given the input called URI and the content values to the insert method, and insert method will internally call the insert method of content provider, and this guy finally will insert the data into the database by using SQLite database insert method. What we have to do, we'll be calling the query method of our content resolver. Query method will internally call the query method of content provider, and in the query method of content provider, I will call the query method of SQLite database. So the flow will always remain same. So every single operation which you need to do, you do it on content resolver. Resolver will further resolve which content provider, and it will call the corresponding method, and this method will further internally execute the SQLite database method. Now let us create one menu in our sign up activity, right? So this was the previous code which we did. In order to create the menu, I am going to my resources. I'll do a right click and I'll say a new Android resource directory. So in the Android resource directory, I'm going to choose a guy called menu, right? And then you say okay. And now in the menu, you say right click and say a new menu resource file. And I'm going to say this is my menu_signup. So in menu_signup, I will drag and drop a menu item. So when you drag and drop a menu item, so you can see there is one item over here. And you can just name this item as all users. So I'm going to give one ID which goes like all users, and you can say app colon show as action if room, right? So this is what we have already seen when we designed the menus. Now coming back to the sign up activity, I'll create a method called on create options menu. So if you want to write a menu, you need to use this method, and you say get menu inflator dot inflate r dot menu dot whatever the menu, and then put it into the menu. So this is how you create a menu in your Android. So this is an implicit way, so you can also use explicit way. You can write menu dot add method to add a menu. Now what should happen if someone clicks on this menu? So you create a method called on options item select. You need to override this method, and now and ID goes like item dot get the item ID. In case your ID is equal to r dot ID dot all users. It means user has selected the all users menu item. Here I need to launch a new activity which shall display all the users. So I need to launch a new activity on click of this menu item. In order to launch a new activity, I'll go back and I'll say a right click and say a new activity, and this goes like empty activity again. Let's name this activity as all users activity and say finish. Now the all users activity over here is going to have a layout file that's like activity underscore all underscore users, and by default whatever the layout file you are going to get is a constraint layout. So let's change this constraint layout to be a list view, and for my list view I am going to provide a padding, and let's say padding goes like 16 dp, and other than that I'm going to give an id which goes like list view. And in my sign up activity you say intent is a new intent. You are going from your sign up activity dot this to all users activity dot class, and you say start the activity with the intent. Now that's how you are going to navigate from your sign up activity to the all users activity, and all users activity will display all the users in the form of a list view. Now in my all users activity, let's write this guy called list view, and you can say @ inject view r dot id dot list view, and out in your on create let's say butter knife dot inject. I think it is clear to everyone. Now list view needs to show the data, and the data is available in the table. We got a lot of records available in the table, but as of now in our table we have just 5 records. In order to retrieve the records from the table, I have created one function called retrieve users. So I got this function called retrieve users, and what I will do exactly in my onCreate method, I will call this function retrieve users. So it means whenever your activity, all users activity will come up, the moment it is created, I will call the method retrieve users. Now what I will do in retrieve users, in my retrieve users, I am supposed to use the content resolver which will call the query method, right? And now let's come back to our all users activity and write one API called content resolver. And how we'll create content resolver? You will say resolver assign get the content resolver. So you are done with your content resolver. If you want to query the data from the table, you first of all need to decide what are the columns which you want to retrieve. So I will create one string array and I will name it like projection. It can be any name of your choice. Now what and all columns you want to retrieve? So you say util dot column underscore id. I want to retrieve the first column, then I will say util dot column underscore name, column underscore email, let's say password. So I am more or less retrieving everything. Then you got gender, and finally you got util dot city. So I have created a string array, right? So where you have mentioned all the columns. You can also mention 2 columns, 3 columns, or just 1 column. So it depends upon your requirement. What are the number of columns which you want to retrieve? Now the next thing goes like, you say resolver dot query. You call the method query. So I'm going to pass only 2 inputs to the query method. The first input is util dot user underscore URI. So yesterday also to the insert method you passed URI. So today also we are passing URI, because URI contains 2 things: authority for the content provider and name of the table, which was the last part segment. Next comma, you put projection and then you say null comma null comma null. So what are the other nulls? So they are like more of the SQL operations, but we are not using them as of now. So I have kept everything as null. When I say resolver.query, so I am calling the query method over here, and this query method is going to execute the query method of content provider. So coming back now, when I will say resolver.query over here, so this query method is going to execute the query method of my content provider. If you can see, the first input is URI and the second input is projection. Then we got selection, selection arcs, sort order and all, but we are not using them. Let's remove the code here. When the call has come to your query method of the content provider, the first thing which you should do is extract the table name from the URI, which is the last path segment. So I got the last path segment as the name of the table. Now, once you have extracted the table name, so the next part is to internally execute the query method of SQLite database. So let's see how we can do that. So I'll come here and I will say SQLite database dot query. And in the query method over here, I'll pass the first input as table name, second input as projection, and then you pass everything else as null. Right? So the input which was coming to the content provider, it was URI and the projection. What we did, we extracted the table name, and projection is given, both of them, table name and projection, is given to the SQLite database query method. As a result, you will have a lot of data now. You will have 5 rows. Over here, you will have 5 rows. And all those rows will be available in an API called Cursor. The way we got result set as a data structure, which will hold the data in your JDBC part of Java. I hope you can recall that. In a similar way, in Android, you got this guy called Cursor. So Cursor is the kind of a data structure which will hold the data retrieved from your table. Now, what is the return type of query method in the content provider? Cursor, right? So what I will do in the end, I will say return the guy called Cursor. Now, who called the query method of content provider? Content resolver. In which class? In all users activity. So here we call the query method, so that returned cursor I'm going to get here. So whenever you say resolver.query, you will end up in landing to the query method of your content provider, where you internally call the SQLite database query method, which returns you the cursor, and here you are returning the same cursor, and this cursor is returned to your all users activity over here. Now, moving ahead, if cursor is not equal to null, let's say the value of cursor is not equal to null, it means that you got data. It means we have data in our result set, that's like your cursor. Now, what I will do, I will take a local variable called I, which is 0, then string name. Then you got email, password, gender, and city. So I got these variables. Now, while cursor dot move to next, it means keep on iterating in the cursor row by row. Now, when you are in the first row, I will say I assign cursor dot get the integer on the first column. So for that I will say cursor dot get the column index of ID. So you need not to remember the IDs of your columns. So we have an API to do so. You say cursor dot get the column index, it will get you the column index, and you pass it into the getInt, so you'll get the value. So ID will be now populated into the eye for the first row. Similarly, you say name assign cursor dot get the string. Now depends upon the data type which you are retrieving. So the column has a type now, right? So if it is having integer type, you say get int. If it is having a textual type, you say get string. Then the internal structure goes same. So internally, I will be saying it's column underscore name. So now you retrieve it for all of the people. We got email, then you got phone, gender and city, right? So you got name, email, password, gender and city. It means when my loop will be executing in its single iteration, I am reading one single row. Once I am reading the single row, what I will be doing is I will be creating one array list now over here. If you can see, I am going to come up with an array list of type user and I am going to name it like user list. It can be any name of your choice. So this user list, in my retrieve users, I say user list is a new array list. Now array list is having a type of user. It means you can only add the user object in the array list. And now what I am going to do, I am going to say user is a new user. You pass the ID, name, email, phone, gender and city. So you created an object out of a row. So firstly, what we did, we saved the data. We saved the data into the object and we saved the data within the object into the table. Now you are retrieving the data back and you are converting each and every single row as an object. And finally, this object which you have created, you are going to add it into your user list. It means my entire data structure called ArrayList over here, which is the user list, is representing my table, right? So the entire table data is available in your data structure called user list. Now, I can also write this instruction in this way. You can say user dot user list dot add a new user, right? So rather than writing it in this way, in that way you can write in this way, right? Why to create an extra reference variable? You directly create an object and you add it into your array list. Now you got the data which is retrieved in the form of your array list. It means that in my sign up activity, when I will click on the menu item all users, I will launch all users activity, and the all users activity will call its onCreateStart method first. So it's a lifecycle callback which will come for the first time, and thereafter you create a resolver and you say retrieve users, and every single row is converted into an object and it is being stored into the user list on index approach from 0 to n minus 1. Now I got the data in my array list and I want to show this data in a list view. So I will use a custom adapter to show the data. It means I need to create my own list item, right? So let's see how we can create a custom adapter now. So I'll come back to my resources and layout and I'll do a right click and I'll say a new layout resource file. Let us name this guy as list underscore item, and now it's a linear layout. So we got this guy as a linear layout. So linear layout over here, let's come back and let's give some padding. And let us, alright, so we are done with the orientation over here. Now in my linear layout, I am going to drag and drop text view 1 and text view 2. So there are two text views in my linear layout. So let us design this a little bit. So the first one is text view name and the second one is, let's say, text view email. So if you want to display a lot of data, you can create more text views and you can use any of the visual component over here. So with this wrap content and wrap content, so this guy is having a margin top of let's say 6 dp and 6 dp over here. So let's say this guy has no margin top and let's give a margin top of 8 dp over here. So we got text color and text size. So the text size of this guy is 18 dp and text color, I am going to choose this color accent. For my name, I am saying the text size is 24 dp and the color goes like color primary dark. Now this is what I have it in my design part, right? So there are two text views. So just change the name, so name and email. This is the design part, guys. I hope we are convinced with it. So name and email, two of the text views. So if you want, you can just say the height goes like wrap underscore content. So now you can get a feel that we got a list item out here, right? So I designed a list item, so it's just a layout file, it's an XML layout. Now the next part over here is to write one adapter. So we know how to create an adapter. You write a Java class. So I'm going to name this class as user adapter. And user adapter extends array adapter. And this array adapter will be of type user, right? So it will be a type user, and now you will get an error. Click on the error bulb, say create constructor, and I will choose a second last option. So the same example we have already seen. You say okay. Now in the user adapter, I got the first guy as context, second is one int resource, and the last one over here, which was list, I have changed this guy to array list. Let's copy these three guys over here. So I'm going to create attributes for the user adapter. So there are three attributes to the user adapter. We got context, then integer resource, and array list, you can name it like user list. Right? For my initialization, I will say this dot context assign context, this dot resource is resource. And finally, you can say user list assign objects. Now, once you have created this guy called user adapter, in all users activity, I will say user adapter as in adapter. And in my retrieve users, after the while loop, I will say adapter is a new user adapter. The first input goes like this, second input is r dot layout dot list item, and the third input goes like your user list. So now your layout is list item over here, and you got the reference to the current object, and this guy is the data structure which contains the data retrieved from the table. So user list is an array list which contains the data retrieved in the form of objects, and now the same thing is being passed to this constructor. So once it is passed to the constructor over here, so the references are copied into the context, resource and user list. Now for my adapter to work, we need to override a function called getView. There is a guy called getView. In the getView, I will just delete this return statement. I will say, let's create a view which is null. And now here you say return the same view. I've returned it. My getView method shall be called n number of times, where n is the size of your array list which you have passed over here. And then further, this array list is copied into the user list. Now moving ahead, I'm going to say view assign layout inflator dot from the context dot inflate. You mention the first input as resource. Now what is resource? This is the list item. Then second input is the parent and third input is the false. So this guy is the parent. and we don't want the parent to be linked with this resource, so we are passing false over here. And next part is now that the reference variable view is pointing to this guy called resource, and this resource over here is the second input which we are passing as our r.layout.listItem. And now in my user adapter, the view which is created, it is pointing to this guy listItem, and this listItem has two text views. So in my user adapter, I'm going to declare two text views. You say text view txt name text view. You say view dot find view by id r dot id dot text view name. And in a similar way, we have the second text view as in text view email. So in my list item, I got the two text views over here, text view name and text view email. Once you are done with this, now you say user user assign user list dot get on the basis of position. So whatever the object is available in my array list, I am retrieving that object one by one on the basis of position. So the first object is 0, then 1, 2, 3, and 4. Since we have 5 records as of now, then I will say txt name dot set the text user dot get the name. So if you want, you can also print the ID. So let's say user dot get the ID. So remember, whenever you are putting an ID on your text view, so it should be concatenated with the string, or it should be converted to the string. So you cannot set the text as an integer, it will give an exception. So convert your integers into the strings and then set it as a text on text view, else it will give you an exception. In my second text view, I got the guy txt email dot set the text. You say user dot get the email. So I'm not displaying everything. So in my retrieve operation now, we are done with the entire code. Let's see, in sign up activity, on click of menu, I will be navigating to all users activity. In all users activity, we said let's retrieve users. When you retrieve users, you created a projection and you said resolver.query. So you got the entire data in the result set called cursor, where you are going to iterate one by one. You are converting every single row as into your object of Java over here. And you are adding the object into the array list. So array list is representing the table and an object is representing a row. Thereafter, you created this guy called adapter, which is a user adapter, and you're passing layout file, array list, and the reference to the current activity. So here you will be getting the three inputs, and the get view method now will run for n number of times, where this position value will change from 0 to n minus 1. Every time you execute the code, you extract one object, and then you set the data on your views, and then you return the view. And now finally, guys, you say your list view dot set the adapter to be adapter. Let's run the code and see the output. Alright, so here you can see a menu coming up as in all users. So this menu we created, so let's click on all users and you can see the data. Five records are here, beautifully coming up as in one list item in the list view. So you can also put more data in case you want, but I think this is good enough. Now come back and let's try to insert more data. Let's say we got the guy called Ron. Add some example.com, Ron123 email. And you select the city and you say sign up. So now again you say all users and you can see the sixth record coming out over here. So whatever you are inserting, you are able to retrieve. So guys, are we good to go till here? So it's a sequence which we are forming. It's a Lego which we are doing, right? So we used the list view, we used ManView, and then we fused it all together with the content provider. So now this code is dynamic. Moving ahead now, I want, if user clicks on any of the item, if someone clicks on the item, we should ask, would you like to view the record or delete the record or update the record? I want to give the options to my user if he clicks on any of the list item, right? So let's see how we can do that. So you say your activity implements on item click listener, because your list view will handle item click listener. So you implement the method called on item click and you say list view dot set on item click listener to be the this. It means if user is going to click on the list item, so every time user clicks on any list item, the function call will be on item click. In my activity, I will declare one reference variable user, and I will also declare one more variable called position. Let's say POS. Whenever someone will click, I will just save the value of I in this position. I will come to know on which position user has clicked. And other than that, I'm going to say user assign user list dot get on the basis of I. So on whatever the position be, if you are going to click, I'm recording the position. I'm also extracting that object which user is going to select. And now I'm going to create one function called show options. So we would like to tell our users what you need to do when you click on the items. For my options, so I'll create one string array known as items. So the options goes like view user, delete user, and finally you got update user. So I got three items. They are in the form of array. It's like 0, 1, and 2. And now I will use the concept called alert dialog. You say alert dialog dot builder. Builder is a new alert dialog dot builder. You pass this. And then I'm going to say builder dot set the items. You say items over here. And then comma new on click listener. And you say builder dot create dot show. I'm going to show this alert dialog with items. And every time a user will click on any of the item, I will show options. Now let's run the code and see what is the difference. So I'm showing an alert dialog in which we are asking the user, would you like to view the user profile? You would like to delete the guy or you would like to update the guy, right? So let's see. So you say all users now. And now when you click on Jenny Watson, it will say view user, delete user, or update user. You click on any guy, so it's going to ask you the same options. Now, I'll implement the first option, view user. I want to view the details of this guy, right? So let's see how we can do that. In order to do that, in my class called user, so over here in the user, I'm going to write one two-string method. So I'll override a two-string method. We know when you will try to print the reference variable, it will call the two-string method. So in this, I will return name plus name. And then you say plus backslash n, two backslash n. And then you can say email plus email. Then I got password, gender, and city. So these are the five details. So name, email, you got password, gender, and city. Good to go? Great. Now in all users activity, I am going to write one function over here. So this goes like void show user. So show user function is also an alert dialog over here. Builder is a new alert dialog dot builder. You pass this and now you say builder dot set the title, and I'm going to say user dot get the name. So I'm setting the name of the user in the title, and then you say builder dot set the message. You say user dot to string. So whatever the data is there, it will be set as a message. So how the data will be set as a message? It's gonna set in this way: name, email, password, gender, and city. Now in my all users activity, I said builder dot set the positive button, which goes like done. What should happen on click of done? Nothing should happen. And then you say builder dot create dot show. Now for my view user option, it is the zero case. This is the case number zero. So you say switch to I. So over here I will be 0, 1 or 2. Now you say case 0, case 1, case 2. In my view user, I will just call the function called show user. Now you run the code and see what will happen. So if you click on any list item, you are going to say show options. And if you use the first option view user, you are going to say show user, and show user is going to display an alert dialog with the data. You say all users, click on John Watson and say view user, and here you are with the data: name, email, password, gender, and city. You click on done, it's gone. Then again, if you want, let's try to click on Fiona. View user, you get the details of Fiona. City is different. View user, details of Ron. Makes a sense now? How you can view the user? Right? So let's wrap up this session till here. For delete and for update of the user, I will take it in the another session. Right? So let's try to conclude the session here itself. Anyone having any query? Because as of now in the flow, it's easy that we have seen a lot of things, but we have developed much of the structures. So what we have done, let's see that part. So from my sign up activity, I actually started with creation of menu. So I went into the resources and into the menu over here, right? And from the menu, I created one menu item called all users. In the sign up activity, we created the menu using on create options menu, and if someone selects on all users, I'm going to start a new activity which is known as all users activity. In my all users activity, we got the layout file as list view, and we have given an ID called list view. So we initialized our list view over here and we injected with the butter knife. Now I created a resolver and I said retrieve users. In my retrieve users, I created one array list, a projection which includes the number of columns which you want to retrieve, and thereafter I said resolver.query. When I say resolver.query, it will call the query method of content provider, right? So when you call the query method, so content provider's query method will be executed, and here you extract the table name, and then you say SQLite database dot query. So you pass the table name and the projection, and it is going to return you a cursor, which you are returning over here. It's a data structure which contains a lot of rows. And now in the all users activity, I will receive the cursor here and I will check for the null. So if it is not null, you iterate in the cursor and you extract the values in the columns one by one. Every single value is stored in a variable, and all the variables are passed into a new object of user, and finally the user object is added into the user list. So here what has happened? User list is representing the entire table, and every user object is representing a row. So thereafter, I need to display the retrieved data on the list view. So we created a guy called adapter called user adapter. And this guy user adapter is a customized adapter, which is an array adapter. For my user adapter, I must have a custom layout file. So I created a list item, which is just having two text views. So designed in a way, one after the other. Right, so it's a linear layout, linear arrangement. In my user adapter, we got the getView method, which will be inflating the view from the resource. So resource is r.layout.listItem, and then you have initialized both the text views. You extract the object of user from the position, and then you set the data on the text views. And now in my all users activity, the same adapter is set on the list view. Your list view also has an item click listener. When you click on any item, I am saving the position on which you have clicked, and I am extracting the user which you have selected. And then I am showing the options. When I am showing the options out here, so I am showing view user and delete user and update user. So case 0, case 1 and case 2. When I am clicking on case 0, which is view user, I'll say show user, and show user will give us an alert dialog with the user.toString method, where the user class is having this toString method over here. You can put a backslash n over here so that you can have a bit more space just below over here. You can have some more space in between. So this goes like the tutorial for the day, how you can do a retrieve operation, and I am able to view the operation. So delete and update operations are very simple, they are small, but we'll do it tomorrow. Let's not try to put everything all together. Anyone having any query now? All right guys, thank you very much.